It is good to be with you again tonight. I hope you're all doing well. And as usual, if you have anything that we need to be praying about, any prayer concerns, or any way that we can help you, we hope that you can get in touch. You can call me or text the church number, which is 608-224-0274, or you can send me an email at fourlakeschurch@gmail.com. As of right now, we're still planning on getting together this coming Lord's Day morning at 9 a.m. And I will also be there at 10:30 a.m., but we will be replaying the 9 o'clock service at 10:30. So I would highly recommend coming at 9 in the morning if you're able to be with us. If you want to watch the replay with just me, that would be fine too as well at 10:30. But last Sunday, I think we only had 12, 13, 14 people at the first service, so there was plenty of room to spread out. Since we're still in a little bit of an outbreak right now in Dane County, I think a few more people are staying home, and that is all right. Do whatever you need to do to be safe. But I hope to see you this coming Sunday at 9 o'clock. If you can make it at 9 o'clock, please be sure to sign up online. And please also remember that we are keeping the doors and the windows open, and it is December now in Wisconsin, if we haven't noticed that. So it's been a little bit chilly the past couple weeks, but it has absolutely been doable. It has not been uncomfortable at all, at least for me. Of course, you know me, loving the cold and the snow. But also remember to bring your own supplies for the Lord's Supper, if at all possible. We're trying to limit what all of us touch as best we can, and we found that that is one more way of keeping us safe. So hope you can join us this coming Sunday at 9. Before we jump into our class tonight, I'm hoping it's all right to share just a little bit more news from my life working as a tabulator for the recount last week. I just mentioned it briefly in the lesson on Sunday, but only as it related to what we were studying at the time from the book of Acts. And since we used to use the first few minutes of our Wednesday class to share good news, this is my good news this week. So I just want to give you a little bit of an update, maybe a little bit more information that I didn't have time to share this last Sunday. Most of you know I've been working as an election official for close to 30 years now, going back to the early 90s. I came home from spring break, and my mom was working as an election official in the Chicago area, and they needed somebody to fill in. And so I got thrown into a ward and ended up helping with the election that spring. And I haven't been able to quit. And I did it for about 7 years when we lived in Janesville, and then jumped in here in Madison shortly after we moved here in 2000. But what I found is that it is a great way to connect with people in the community, and that was certainly true this past week as well. I know that it is easy for some preachers to hole up in an office and get out of touch a little bit, and that's a temptation that goes along with the kind of work that this is. But this has given me another excuse to get out there in the community, and even this week I had some great conversations about the Lord and His church. And I found it interesting that word got around, and before the week was over, whenever we'd have a break, I would have people coming up to me just out of the blue. "I heard you're a minister. What kind of church are you at? Where do you preach? Where is that located? What kind of church is that? How big is your church?" And on and on and on. Just had some interesting questions that I really did not instigate, but word got around, and I thought that was interesting, and we did have some very good conversations. Without me hounding people about it, they were approaching me, and I found that to be interesting. I mentioned this in the lesson on Sunday that I helped supervise this one. It went well. I was nervous about that, but thankfully it went well. I heard some good comments from fellow tabulators and from the attorneys and from the clerk's office and from observers about how well it went at our tables. On the first day, we started very small. They had arranged all of our municipalities in order from smallest to largest. So the first half of the recount was everything other than Madison, from smallest to largest. And about halfway through, we started with Madison, from smallest to largest of the wards within the city. Our very first unit that we did was a small batch, I think of about 78 votes, from a small part of Edgerton that falls within Dane County. Most of Edgerton is in Rock County. And so we started with that tiny little batch of ballots from the Dane County part of Edgerton just to get us started so we could figure out what we were doing. And the county clerk gave us a rough outline of what we needed to do, but we were in a sense making it up as we went along. We had the law, we knew what we had to do, which was recount all of the votes cast for president in Dane County. But beyond that, it was up to us to come up with some system and to make it happen. And most of you know I am not a numbers person. I hate math. And so, which is interesting that I'm helping to do a recount. Maybe that's why they chose me. They might have done that on purpose. But anyway, all I had was a clipboard and a notepad and 20 people, most of whom were fellow chief inspectors and municipal clerks from around Dane County. So here I was trying to keep all of this straight and get this going, double counts of absentee envelopes, double counts, inspections of ballots, and looking for all kinds of stuff. And I kept finding myself scribbling here and there and columns and going back and forth from my scratch paper to the checklist and all that. It was a little bit chaotic, that first little batch from Edgerton. And so the next morning I got up at 4:30 in the morning and I developed something of a worksheet. And that's what I'm putting on the screen here. Just, I think it's interesting. We had more than 300,000 ballots plus envelopes still left to tally. So I needed help, and that explains what I've put on the screen here. I kept the names of the people I was working with at the top, and I've found, and you've probably known this from your own experience, that when you know the names of the people that you're working with, it goes a lot better, and just personalizes it there. So I made a name for a place for the name of the clerk and the tabulators up there in the unit we were working on, and then a little section for what we were expecting from the inspector's statement on election day, and then what we're actually finding on the table in front of us. So those are compared right and left up there at the top. And then I numbered my tables 1 through 10 on each side, and then I had a way to tally what we were counting and room to track a first and a second count. And then down at the bottom I made a checklist for what we need to do after we've counted, and where to go from there before moving on to the next municipality. So I emailed this to the county clerk early the next morning and made some copies for myself, and the clerk copied this for everybody else there. And I would say we revolutionized the recount. We made it a lot smoother after that first day because of the sheet that we developed. And so that is my good news for the week, and thankful that it went as well as it did. On the top left is a picture of one of our tabulators looking away from the camera there, and then two observers looking at an absentee ballot envelope there. So this was my view for most of the week, pacing up and down among these 20 tables and just making sure that it all went well. And then on the bottom is kind of a bird's eye view. This was one of the live streams that went out on YouTube, just making this as open and transparent as possible. So that's a screenshot from NBC15 this past week. And I'm the tiny guy with a clipboard standing in front of the table facing the camera there. And that was my week, but I am so incredibly thankful that it is over and we got that out of the way. Tonight we're going to get back to our pause in studying the book of Luke, and we're wrapping up our study of a worksheet on baptism. So we've had two parts up to this point. Tonight will be part three as we finish. I've tried to put a link to the worksheet on the description under the YouTube video. It's on our website under articles under the Grow tab. I think I've also put it in the comments under the link to tonight's class in the Facebook group. So it's available in a number of different places. I've also mailed it to most of you about 3 weeks ago, those of you who join us on the phone. So if you do not have this, if you would like to have a copy and still don't have a copy, please let me know and I'd be glad to get it to you in whatever way works best for you. But it would be very helpful if you could have this in front of you on paper, if at all possible, so we can fill in some things as we move through it. We're studying this because there is quite a bit of confusion out there in the religious world on the subject of baptism, from infant baptism to the idea that baptism isn't even necessary at all. There's a lot of false teaching that's going on. And much of this goes back to the timing of baptism. Where should baptism land on a timeline of our own spiritual history? And so that's the basic question that we get down to with the study of baptism with many people. Because of this confusion, we started 2 weeks ago by noting a series of questions there at the top of the worksheet. And the goal here is we want people to be sure of what they have done personally. And I know often when people worship with us for a while, it's very easy to hear what we're saying over a period of weeks or even months, and then they try to project that back onto their own personal experience. And we're not saying that they're dishonest in doing that. That is just a natural human tendency. But since what we understand at the time we were baptized is so important, we need to allow people to make sure in their own minds what they have actually done without being influenced by us. And so we have these questions. And as we study, I might help the person I'm studying with work through these things, but I need to make really sure that I am not leading or suggesting answers here. So I'll fill this out at the same time on my own behalf, but it's important that I don't influence their answers. I'll share my answers only after we go through theirs. So this is why we have these questions at the beginning and not at the end of this. And again, this is probably not for our benefit tonight, at least most of you who are joining us in this format today. It might be beneficial to you personally, and that's great, that's awesome if it is, but that's not our goal tonight. Our goal tonight as Christians is to get familiar with this study guide as a resource, as a tool, so that we can go out and be prepared, training ourselves to use this with others. So in these six questions, we try to bring some clarity concerning what someone has actually done in terms of baptism. Have they made a commitment to Christ? And if so, at what age? We let them fill this out. Was there any kind of confession involved at the time you made a commitment to the Lord? And if so, what was that confession? Have they been baptized at any point in the past? If so, describe that action. Was it sprinkling? Was it pouring? Was it immersion? When did it take place? What was it like? Was there any delay between the commitment that you made and your baptism? What was the purpose of their baptism? Were they saved before or at the point of baptism? And if necessary, it might be helpful to actually make a timeline to help this make sense. And I've done that on a piece of paper, on a napkin with people. I've done it at the church building and one of the whiteboards in our classrooms downstairs. Okay, here is the moment you believed. Here is when you were baptized. Is there a gap? If so, when? When did you get added to the church? We'll lay all of that out on a timeline, and we need to get that nailed down before we actually start looking at the scriptures and start projecting back what we learned tonight on what we've actually done in the past. So I hope that makes sense. And as that little paragraph explains, the next one under the questions, this sheet contains every reference to Jesus' baptism in water after the Lord's resurrection. So we're not dealing with John's baptism, John the Baptist. We don't have time to get into that. We're not dealing with Holy Spirit baptism. That's kind of a study for another time, but we're focusing on Jesus' baptism in water after his resurrection and ascension and toward the end of the New Testament. We're just going to go through these scriptures. So 2 weeks ago, we made it through the first four references, two accounts of the Great Commission, Peter's sermon, and then the baptism of the 3,000 on the day of Pentecost, and then finally, the baptism of a number of men and women up in Samaria. We learned from those four passages that baptism is for those who are old enough to be students, old enough to be disciples, old enough to feel guilt, old enough to believe in the Lord, old enough to repent, to have a change of heart. We don't see that in little babies. They don't need to repent. They haven't sinned. We really didn't find too much as to the action of baptism, whether it's sprinkling, pouring, or immersion. Remember, we're not looking at the Greek word. We're not going deep in that way here, but we're looking at the context. And in the context, we didn't find much on the action itself. We did learn as to the timing that belief comes before baptism and that people were baptized the same day they believed, almost immediately. There was no delay of weeks or months or years. We learned that baptism is for the forgiveness of sins, that it is essential to salvation, that it's in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, which, as we discussed, means that it is done by God's authority or with God's approval or with God's permission. So all of this is just a quick summary from 2 weeks ago. So let's keep working our way through this and notice what we looked at last week. We looked at the next six references on the study guide, Acts 8, the baptism of the Ethiopian treasurer by the side of the road. We looked at Paul or Saul's conversion in Acts 9 with the other little reference in Acts 22:16 as he retold this event. We looked at the baptism of the Roman centurion Cornelius and his household in Acts 10. We looked at the baptism of Lydia and her household in Acts 16. We looked at the Philippian jailer's baptism and his household in the last half of Acts 16. And then we also looked at the baptism of several in Corinth in Acts 18. And so in these accounts, we learn baptism once again is intended for adults, treasurers, persecutors, centurions, businesswomen, jailers, religious leaders. They're all old enough to sin. They're old enough to hear the gospel. They're old enough to believe it. And they're old enough to feel guilt over sin and old enough to make a decision to turn away from sin or repent. Based on what happened with the man on his way back home to Ethiopia, we learn the baptism requires stopping a chariot as to the action. It means stopping the chariot, going down into the water, coming up out of the water afterwards. And so we learn something about the action there. It is an immersion in water. It was not something that he could have done in his chariot. We learn from several of these that baptism is specifically described as happening immediately, at the very hour, in the middle of the night, and so on. So there is no delay in these accounts between making the decision to obey the Lord and actually obeying the Lord. And the reason is the purpose of baptism is to wash away sins, as we learn from what Ananias said to Saul. And so if I really understand what baptism is, there is no possible way that I will delay. And in fact, I would go so far as to say that if you delay baptism by a few days, weeks, or months, then really you probably do not truly understand what is involved in it. And if I know what's at stake there, I will not put it off even a minute. And then we had some other details over in the right-hand column. So let's move on and continue on beyond Acts 18:8. We're going to conclude our study. And let's move on to the next reference on our sheet. And the first reference tonight comes in Acts chapters 18 and 19. It's actually the first and the only reference to what we might describe as rebaptism in the Bible. Basically, it shows that if we misunderstood, or if we didn't have enough information, or if we had false or wrong information the first time, we really need to do it properly, even if it means being baptized again. The chapter division between Acts 18 and 19 is a little bit unfortunate, so I want us to read the whole thing, the last paragraph of Acts 18 and the first paragraph of Acts 19, because at the end of Acts 18, we find that a preacher has been preaching error without knowing it. And so he's preaching in ignorance, and he's doing a good job of it. He's an eloquent man. So he's very convincing. He's a good public speaker, but he's wrong. And that's a warning to all preachers. We need to be careful with what we teach. And at the beginning of Acts 19, Paul shows up to the exact same place where this preacher had been preaching the error, the city of Ephesus, and Paul has to correct the situation. So let's look at Acts 18, 24 down through chapter 19, verse 7. Now a Jew named Apollos, an Alexandrian by birth, an eloquent man, came to Ephesus, and he was mighty in the scriptures. This man had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in spirit, he was speaking and teaching accurately the things concerning Jesus, being acquainted only with the baptism of John. And he began to speak out boldly in the synagogue. But when Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they took him aside and explained to him the way of God more accurately. And when he wanted to go across to Achaia, the brethren encouraged him and wrote to the disciples to welcome him. And when he had arrived, he greatly helped those who had believed through grace, for he powerfully refuted the Jews in public, demonstrating by the scriptures that Jesus was the Christ. It happened that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul passed through the upper country and came to Ephesus and found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" And they said to him, "No, we have not even heard whether there is a Holy Spirit." And he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" And they said, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in him who is coming after him, that is, in Jesus." When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they began speaking with tongues and prophesying. There were in all about 12 men. So notice up at the end of Acts 18, we've got Apollos. He is an eloquent man. He's preaching in Ephesus, but for some reason, he is still preaching the baptism of John the Baptist. And I know this hasn't been a part of this study, but John's baptism was an immersion, so the action was the same, very similar to Jesus' baptism. It followed repentance. It was for the forgiveness of sins, and so it had a lot in common with what we've been talking about. However, John's baptism was looking forward to Jesus, instead of looking back at Jesus' own death, burial, and resurrection. But most importantly, John's baptism didn't result in being given the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so Apollos is a powerful preacher, but his message is a few years out of date. His preaching is inaccurate. I would compare it to an accountant giving tax advice based on tax law from the mid-1980s. It might have been great advice 30 years ago, but it'll get you in trouble if you follow it now. Does that make sense? Apollos was a powerful preacher, but he was preaching a message that was out of date. He was promoting John's baptism when the baptism of John the Baptist was no longer in effect, and so he needed to be corrected. We notice then that a husband and wife, Priscilla and Aquila, hear Apollos preaching, and a red flag shoots up in their mind. Something's wrong, and so they take him aside. And Luke, the author here, says that they explain to him the way of God more accurately. Notice they don't publicly humiliate the man. They don't stand up in the synagogue, "Wait a minute, man, you're wrong here. How could you be so ignorant?" They don't do that. But they correct him, they pull him aside, they correct him privately. I would also point out that Priscilla plays a role in this. She's not preaching publicly. She is not teaching a Bible class, as we would say today. And yet, along with her husband, she enlightens this gospel preacher privately. Some of you might remember we had a man come through the congregation here in Madison many years ago who firmly believed with all his heart that women should never be allowed to make any contribution to any Bible class in any way whatsoever. And he even went so far as to say, even if two men are discussing scripture privately in the aisle after church is over, a woman cannot walk up and contribute to that discussion in any way. That did not go over well. I have strong disagreements with that man and the way that he taught that and what he believes there. According to him, it was a sin for a woman in any way to transmit biblical knowledge or to enlighten a male biblically in any way. Well, I mentioned this passage. I said, well, what about Priscilla and Aquila? And when I brought this up with him, he suggested that Priscilla's role in this discussion was to fluff the pillows. That is exactly what he said. However, I want us to notice that Luke, the author of this passage, points out that they took Apollos aside and explained to him the way of God more accurately. And I would suggest, based on what the Bible actually says here, that this was a team effort. Priscilla and Aquila did this together. They did it in a private setting. It was not public preaching. It was not a Bible class as we would describe it today. But Priscilla and Aquila took this man aside privately and explained the way of God more accurately. In fact, I find it interesting personally that Priscilla's name is actually usually mentioned first when these two are referred to in Scripture. It's not Aquila and Priscilla, it is Priscilla and Aquila. Okay, I don't know if that's significant. Sometimes things like that are significant. I think it's interesting. Sometimes I wonder why. And my assumption is, my personal opinion on this is, Priscilla is probably the more spiritually mature part of that marriage. That's just conjecture on my part, but personally, I know some couples like this. You may know some couples like this. It's not a criticism. It's just the way that it is, where the wife may be more spiritually mature than her husband is. But whatever the case was, we know without a doubt from Scripture that they, that is Priscilla and Aquila, pull this preacher aside privately and they bring him up to speed on baptism. And notice we have no indication that Apollos gets all bent out of shape on this. He doesn't get offended. He doesn't quit. But he progresses. He moves on. He learns something and he goes on from there. And then when he wants to continue preaching somewhere else, the church writes a letter encouraging the disciples on the other end to welcome him. And we do the very best that we can to do the same thing today, writing the church ahead of time where somebody's moving and saying, hey, we know these people. Help them to get plugged in as they were here. That's a biblical concept. In Acts 19, Paul shows up in Ephesus, where Apollos had been, And notice he runs into a group of 12 men who've been baptized improperly. And I find it interesting here that he quizzes these men just a little bit. I might compare it to our, what is it, 6 questions or so up at the top of the worksheet. He asks them some questions, and he clarifies, and he helps them to understand what they actually went through. And so we have biblical precedent for that. We're not grilling people. This is not some inquisition. But we need to get to the bottom of it. We need to help them understand what they've actually done and what they've been through. And he figures out that the act itself was an immersion. It was John's baptism, but it was for the wrong reason. And so it wasn't just the act itself that's important, sprinkling, pouring, or immersion. Make sure it's immersion, of course. It's not just that. But it's what we know at the time that we were baptized that's important as well. Another note here, the ability to speak in tongues and to prophesy was not automatic at the point of baptism, but instead, Paul had to actually lay his hands on these men. And this fits in with what we find earlier in Acts chapter 8. People didn't come up out of the water speaking in tongues. That's not the way it happens, as some religious groups claim today. But instead, those gifts had to be transmitted from an apostle through the laying on of the apostle's hands. And so on our chart, we might note that these 12 are men. They're not little babies. They're not children. They're old enough to be students, followers, disciples of Jesus. There's no information, new information on the action itself as to when they were baptized, when they heard in verse 5. There's no delay. When they heard, they were baptized. We don't have anything explicitly stated concerning the purpose. Under other, we might note that this is an example of rebaptism. I try to be careful with the term rebaptism, though. We use it accommodatively, we might say. If somebody is rebaptized because they understood it improperly the first time, then they really aren't truly being rebaptized, are they? I hope that makes sense to you. In fact, they are simply being baptized properly the first time. And so when we speak of rebaptism, we're kind of acknowledging that what they think was baptism the first time really isn't, and that we really need to go back and do it properly for the first time. But we kind of term it rebaptism because from their point of view, that's what's happening. I would also caution us against encouraging people to get rebaptized just to be sure, or better safe than sorry. I've heard people explain it in that way. Well, we'll just get baptized again just in case. And we'll just in case, we'll get you in the water. That's not really the way we need to be explaining this. Instead, we need to decide, according to the scriptures, am I saved or am I lost right now? If I'm lost, if I'm not baptized properly, if I'm lost, I need to obey the gospel immediately. But if I'm saved, then I don't need to be rebaptized. There's really no such thing as being baptized just in case it wasn't done correctly the first time. Either it was or it wasn't. And we need to figure that out in order to do it properly. We could also note something here about the ability to perform miracles only coming through the laying on of the apostles' hands. And since we don't have any apostles today, that's one of several reasons why we know we don't have the ability to perform miraculous gifts today. That just kind of, but with somebody studying this, that may open up a whole new aspect or can of worms, we might say. So I don't know if we want to mention that or not, but it does give us some insight into what we're dealing with here. All right, we now move from the book of Acts into Paul's letters. And the first reference to baptism in Paul's letters comes in Romans chapter 6. This is Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 7. Romans 6, 1 through 7. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin so that grace may increase? May it never be. How shall we who died to sin still live in it? Or do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him in order that our body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be slaves to sin. For he who has died is freed from sin. There's obviously quite a bit we could say about this passage, but at least in terms of our study guide here, do we have any clue in the passage itself concerning how old these people are? Obviously, baptism is for those who are old enough to sin. And it's not that sin is inherited genetically, as some people teach, but sin is something we do. Sin is something we commit, rebellion against God, doing what we know to be wrong, crossing a line that God has told us not to cross, and so on. This is not something we do when we're a week or two old. What about the action? Do we have any clue here concerning whether baptism is sprinkling, pouring, or immersion? Absolutely, yes, we do have a clue here. Notice, baptism is described as a burial. We are buried with him through baptism into death. And so baptism is a burial. And today, just as we don't bury people by sprinkling dirt on a casket and calling it a day, so also we don't baptize people by sprinkling water on their heads. We don't really have anything here concerning the when. As to the purpose, what do we find here? What does baptism do for you, according to this passage? Why should we be baptized, according to Paul here? Well, Paul says that we are baptized into Christ Jesus. We are baptized to be united with him in the likeness of his death, so that we can be united with him in the likeness of his resurrection. So do we want to be united with Jesus? Do we want to be united with him in the likeness of his resurrection? If so, this passage tells us that baptism plays a role in that process. Baptism is how we come into contact with the Lord's death. We are buried with him in baptism. And so, is it essential to salvation? Absolutely it is, based on the purpose that's given here. As to other, we find here baptism follows death to sin. We might describe that as repentance. We die to sin and then we're baptized. In the same way, baptism is also connected to walking in newness of life. And so we're baptized, and when we come up out of the water, a new life is what happens afterwards. The Christian life begins at the point of baptism. I would also note that when we do all of this, Paul says in verses 6 and 7 that we are no longer slaves to sin. So we're no longer ruled by sin. We are no longer controlled by sin in our lives. So we need to make sure we note all of this on the chart. Old enough to sin, it's a burial, we're baptized with Christ into his death, and so on, making sure that we summarize what's happened here. The next reference to baptism in Paul's letters comes in 1 Corinthians 1. This past Sunday, we looked at something that happened in Thessalonica. Well, when Paul leaves Thessalonica, he goes on down to Athens, then to Corinth, where he establishes the church there. And not too long after leaving Corinth, he writes this letter back to the church. And he seems to be answering a series of questions or concerns. And there were many concerns that the church in Corinth had. Over and over again in 1 Corinthians, Paul will say, now concerning this, now concerning that. And it's like he's answering a series of bullet points that they wrote to him in a letter. And so they had a lot of issues at that congregation. Now, some have looked at that and they've said, well, since the church in Corinth had a lot of issues, and since Paul loves them anyway, then it must not really matter that we be too concerned about accurate teaching today, because Paul still considered these people brothers and sisters in the Lord. I've heard that argument, maybe you have as well. However, it seems to me that we really need to be concerned about how the Christians in Corinth react to Paul's correction and instruction in this letter. We assume they read the letter and make corrections based on what we read in 2 Corinthians. They seem to have corrected some issues. On the other hand, if they had read this letter and had ignored it, if they had read this letter and said, yeah, all of those are pretty good concerns Paul has here, but he still loves us as brothers and sisters anyway, so let's just continue on as we are. If they had said that, as some people today seem to be advocating based on their take on 1 Corinthians, if they had ignored Paul's corrections, I am thinking that his attitude in 2 Corinthians would be dramatically different than what it actually is, that he would have really come down hard on that. One of the first issues Paul confronts is religious division. Literally, they were denominating. They were dividing based on names. That's what denominating is. We might even say that this is the first hint of denominationalism in the Bible. The church was splitting into factions based on the name of their favorite preachers. Let's notice 1 Corinthians 1, verses 10 through 17. Now I exhort you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all agree, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be made complete in the same mind and in the same judgment. For I have been informed concerning you, my brethren, by Chloe's people, that there are quarrels among you. Now I mean this, that each one of you is saying, I am of Paul, and I of Apollos, and I of Cephas, and I of Christ. Has Christ been divided? Paul was not crucified for you, was he? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one would say you were baptized in my name. Now I did baptize also the household of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized any other. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not in cleverness of speech, so that the cross of Christ would not be made void. In the big picture here, let's just get it in our minds that religious division is wrong. We are not to divide based on the name of any human leader. As most of you know, we have a church very close to us in the neighborhood near our church building, known as St. Paul's AME Church. And sometimes I wonder, what would Paul do if he could visit and drive by and see a church named in his honor? Certainly, this group named their church in Paul's honor. They meant it as a compliment, I'm sure. And yet I think I understand that if Paul saw that, he would be absolutely horrified to see it. In fact, that is exactly what he communicates here. That seems to be what was happening. They were splitting based on names of famous preachers. Notice we have Apollos, who we just learned from Acts was an eloquent man. And so some were saying, I like how this guy talks. He's a smooth talker. I'm following Apollos. I'm with that guy. In response, Paul says he's thankful that he baptized none of them except for Crispus and Gaius and a few others. Now, some have taken this as Paul downplaying the role of baptism. But what he's saying here is that his goal was not to come to Corinth just to rack up a bunch of baptisms. His goal was not to put some notches in his belt, as we might say today. But his goal was to preach the gospel. What happens after that is up to the people hearing the gospel. When I first started preaching, I read this passage and I wondered, how could it be possible for Paul not to remember everybody that he baptized? But now, after a few decades, I understand. For the first decade or so, I kept a list in my wallet. A list of everybody I baptized, and I'm not exactly sure why. Record keeping. I think my goal was to whip out that list on my deathbed and think back over some of the good that I've done. That was a very immature way of thinking, but I kept a list. Over time, I realized that was kind of stupid, and just stopped doing that. And today, looking back, I'll run across a name on one of my monthly reports from 20 years ago. In fact, these worksheets, I'll write the name, my name, the date, and the person I'm studying with. And I've run across a lot of these worksheets. In fact, the one we're looking at tonight, I've seen copies with my scribbling all over it in those blanks with the name of somebody at the top that I don't even remember. And it says they were baptized after it. I'm like, I don't even remember that guy. I know I baptized him, but I don't remember the names. And I think that's what Paul is saying here. He came to Corinth not to rack up numbers, not to keep a list of everybody he baptized, but to preach the gospel. That's his mission. And whether the people obey the gospel in baptism, that's up to them. That's up to those who are listening. On our chart, we have basically nothing concerning the age, the action, the timing, the purpose. However, I would make some comments under other. Notice we're baptized in Christ's name. We've discussed this before up above, haven't we? And this is not only possible but necessary because Christ was crucified for us. That's why we don't follow any human leader. They haven't been crucified for us. So I can't say that I'm a follower of Paul. He didn't die for me. Jesus did. I'm a follower of Christ. I am a Christian. And so closely tied to this, also notice baptism is necessary before calling ourselves Christians. If I'm going to say I am of Christ, it's necessary that I be baptized in his name. Otherwise, I can't call myself of Christ. Those two go together. The other note here is that religious division is sinful. And again, that's not the main point of our study, but that is the main point of this passage. Again, most people today think division is good. Religious division is healthy. It's good to have 400 denominations here in Madison. We've got options. I can find a church that agrees with me. I can take an online quiz, and I can find a church that approves of what I already do and believe. That is absolutely not what Paul suggests here. In fact, he condemns this. In matters of faith, we must all agree, he says, and there must not be any divisions or denominating among us. In matters of faith, we are to be of the same mind and of the same judgment. Later in 1 Corinthians, we have another very brief reference to baptism in 1 Corinthians 12:13, where Paul says, "For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit." Again, we have nothing for most of our categories on the chart, but what about baptism being essential for salvation? I think we could make that argument from this passage. We are baptized into one body. The body is the church. It's necessary to be in the Lord's church in order to be saved. Therefore, baptism indeed is essential for salvation. So I can safely put a yes in the essential to salvation column. That's what I've done on the chart here. We are baptized into one body, which is the Lord's church. We find something very similar in the next passage, Galatians 3, 26 and 27. "For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ." So I would ask, is it important to be clothed with Christ? Baptism is pictured here as putting on Christ, just as we would also cover ourselves in a piece of clothing. And so yes, this does teach that baptism is necessary for salvation. It might help to turn that around a little bit. Can we be saved without being clothed with Christ? No, we can't. And so we must be baptized in order to be clothed with Christ. And so this gets reflected on the chart. Being baptized is how we put on Christ. We are clothed with Him or covered with Him in the act of baptism. The next reference here to baptism in Paul's letters comes in Ephesians 4. In the list of seven ones, as Paul says, "There is one body and one Spirit, just as also you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all." We have almost nothing in terms of our chart. That's all right. However, we should note here that by the time Paul writes this, somewhere between 60 to 62 AD, he says that there is only one baptism. Of course, a lot of people today would argue that there are three baptisms, sprinkling, pouring, or immersion, or more. There's Holy Spirit this and that and all kinds of stuff. But Paul says in 60 to 62 AD when he writes this, there is one baptism. And so in keeping with what we've already learned on these passages, this is not John's baptism. This is not Holy Spirit baptism. This is not the baptism of fire. But this is Jesus' baptism and immersion in water for the forgiveness of sins that he's talking about here. Also, some religious groups today will give you the choice, as I just alluded to, sprinkling, pouring, or full immersion. That choice would have made no sense to those in the ancient world, because there is one baptism at this moment. And the Bible speaks with one voice on this. So on our chart, I would just note that by the time Paul writes this, there's one baptism, not sprinkling, pouring, or immersion, or any other kind of baptism for that matter. There is one baptism. The next reference in Paul's letters comes in Colossians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. Colossians 2, verses 12 and 13. "Having been buried with him in baptism, in which also you were raised up with him through faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. When you were dead in your transgressions and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he made you alive together with him, having forgiven us all our transgressions." We have a few more on our chart on this one, starting with the age of those who are baptized. What clue do we have here? Again, it's not a specific age. Doesn't say 12, doesn't say 18, doesn't say 21. But what do we find here that may give us an idea concerning the age of those being baptized? Well, first of all, in verse 12, Paul refers to having faith, doesn't he? Newborns aren't to that point yet, and that's okay. The other clue comes in verse 13, as Paul refers to being dead in your transgressions. He's referring to those who sin. To refer to a baby as being dead in sin, that's a sick thought. That's awful. That's abhorrent. So children do not sin. Jesus told us to be like children. And so as to the age here, there is sin involved. There is faith involved. These people are old enough to be held accountable. They're old enough to do something about it. What about the action? Do we have any action here? Any clues concerning what we're talking about? Sprinkling, pouring, or immersion? Yes. Paul once again refers to having been buried with him in baptism. Baptism, again, is described as a burial, just as it was back in Romans 6. We have nothing concerning the timing, the when, We do have something that adds to our understanding of the purpose. Notice, at the moment of baptism, God made you alive. At the point of baptism, He has forgiven us all our transgressions. And so baptism is tied to spiritual life and forgiveness. So yeah, it's absolutely essential to salvation. Finally, under other, I would just point out the benefit for the benefit of those who claim baptism is a work, and therefore can't be necessary since we're not saved by works. For those who say this, notice who it is who's doing the work in this passage. Who's working? When we're baptized, we are raised up with Him through faith in the working of God. When we allow ourselves to be buried and raised up in baptism, we are putting our faith not in our own work, but in God's work. God is the one who's doing the work here. And so baptism is in no way a work of human achievement that somehow makes us deserving of salvation. Even the act of baptism itself is passive, isn't it? The Bible says, have faith, repent of your sins, confess. These are things we actively do. And then we are to be baptized. It doesn't say go baptize yourselves. Baptism is something that we allow to happen to us. Somebody does it to us. And I hope that makes sense as well. We are passive. There's nothing we can brag about here saying that I accomplished the act of baptism. That is not at all what's going on, but rather God is the one who is actively doing the work. So on the worksheet, we summarize this. We've got faith involved. We're buried and raised. Baptism makes us alive. It offers forgiveness. God is the one who's doing the work here. We don't earn anything. We're just obeying. God is the one who does the work of forgiveness. We now come to our last passage, the last reference to baptism in the New Testament. And this one comes from Peter. So we're back to Peter. Remember, Peter preached the first sermon there in Acts chapter 2. So we're back to Peter after having taken a break with Paul here. And this is comes after a discussion of Noah and the great flood. And picking up in 1 Peter 3:21, Peter says this, corresponding to that, baptism now saves you, not the removal of dirt from the flesh, but an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. As to the age, we find that the conscience is involved, and again, little children don't really have a conscience that needs to be cleansed in any way. They're not guilty of anything yet. And so we're talking about those who are old enough to feel guilt, those who are old enough to be held accountable. We don't have anything under the action or the wind. We do have something in terms of the purpose, though, don't we? It cannot get any more clearer than this. What is the purpose of baptism here? Obviously, the purpose is salvation. Baptism now saves you, Peter says. A lot of people wish this wasn't in the Bible, but it is. And so is it essential for salvation? Yes, it does not get more clear than that. And then under other, I might note that baptism is tied to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. As we did just a few weeks ago in another study, we just briefly took out that parenthetical statement in the middle of the verse to help it make sense. Corresponding to that, baptism now saves you through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In the act of baptism, we are saved through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We are being raised from the dead. It's a very physical recreation of what happened to the Lord. So in baptism, we are saved through His resurrection. And that parenthetical statement added back in there gives us more information. In the act of baptism, we are making an appeal to God for a good conscience. Baptism is how we cry out to God. Baptism is our way of saying, save us, Lord. And it, of course, is a God-approved way. It is the only God-approved way of doing that. We would then summarize this in our chart in just a few words. Old enough to have the conscience involved, we are baptized to be saved. It is tied to the resurrection of Jesus, and baptism is how we appeal to God for a good conscience. So now at the end, we total our columns, and I feel like this is a presidential recount tabulator worksheet going on here. But keeping in mind that we can't just pick and choose concerning what the Bible teaches on baptism, I can't just go through this chart and say, I'll take this, 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 and this, and ignore all of these. I can't do that. We have to take all of it together. So if you could add words, this is what we're doing here. I know you can't literally total a column of words, but taking all of this together on the age, old enough to sin, old enough to feel guilt, old enough to be students, old enough to be held accountable, old enough to hear, old enough to understand the good news. As to the action, a burial in water, requiring a person to go down into the water and to come up out of the water afterwards. It is an immersion, a burial in water. As to the when, the timing of this, immediately upon hearing and believing the gospel without delay, that same hour of the night. As to the purpose, it is for the purpose of being saved, for the forgiveness of sins, to wash away sins, for the purpose of being clothed with Jesus. Is it essential to salvation? Absolutely yes, over and over and over again. As to everything else we can learn, we're baptized by God's authority, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus. Preaching Jesus equals preaching baptism. That's another big one here. You can't take out baptism from the story of Jesus without mutilating the gospel message. His ministry started with his own baptism and ended with him telling his disciples to go baptize everybody on this planet. Jesus was all about baptism. As to the timing, baptism is followed by rejoicing. Baptism is never preceded by rejoicing. We never have people being saved and rejoicing and then being baptized. It doesn't happen that way. Never has. It's the other way around. Another note, good people still need to be baptized. You can be a good, moral, upright member of society, tithing to a church somewhere, as the Cornelius, the centurion, was. He was tithing to the Jewish synagogue, and yet he was still lost. He was a decent, upright, moral human being, but was still commanded to be baptized. A person needs to be rebaptized when baptized improperly the first time. We're baptized into the Lord's body, his church, the kingdom. And then finally, our baptism is an appeal to God for a good conscience. And this brings us to the end of our study. Again, our goal here was not just for us to learn, but our goal was to become more familiar with this as a tool for teaching others, and that has been our goal with the other worksheets as well. If you have any questions, if you have anything we need to add to this, if there's something that I've missed, something needs to be clarified, I would invite you to get in touch. If you're studying this and you know you need to be baptized, call me right now, and I would be glad to work on that with you. 608-224-0274. There's another worksheet I want to study, but I want to save that for some future class. And next week, I hope we can finally get back to our study of the book of Luke. It is hard to believe that we are getting so close to the end of Luke. And not just that we're coming near the end of Luke, but we're also about to finish studying every verse in the entire Bible as a congregation. It's a different congregation than it was more than 20 years ago, but we started with the book of Acts back in April 2000, and over the past 20 plus years, we have worked our way through pretty much every verse in the entire Bible, except for the last four chapters in the book of Luke. We are almost there. So let us hang in together with each other. We can make it. We can do this. It might take us a few more than 4 weeks because we've got some long chapters coming up, but that is all right. We are studying Jesus, and we're looking forward to it. So come prepared next week then by reading Luke 20. And come prepared with the harmony of the Gospels. We left off around the end of September at the end of chapter 19, so it's been a while. You may remember Josh Yancey taught for 3 weeks from Hebrews while I was out in Washington, and then we've looked at these worksheets over the past month or so, but we are now back to Luke. Thank you again for being with us tonight, either online or on the phone. Be sure to send me any prayer concerns so I can get those in the bulletin. And next week, let's come prepared by being ready to study Luke chapter 20. As we close tonight, let's go to God in prayer. Our Father in heaven, thank you for listening to our prayers, and thank you for the great privilege of being able to come to you with our concerns, and thank you for hearing our requests. You are a God who sent your only Son to this world to save sinners, to seek and to save the lost. And we pray tonight that we would open our eyes to see the lost, that we would get to know them, that we'd be able to call them by name just as your Son did, and that we would be able to point them to you by using your word in a way that makes sense and in a way that is convincing. Give us the courage to speak up. Tonight we ask for your continued blessings on our seniors. Bless those who are struggling with their health, not only physically, but mentally and emotionally as well, those who are burdened down with the everyday cares of life. We pray that you would bless those who are struggling with their faith. You are a God who seeks and saves, and we ask that we might join you in that mission. We come to you tonight in the name of Jesus, your Son, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.